Dear brothers and sisters, once more, we are all welcome to this day's ministration. And today we are going to take our prayer and the biblical reading from Genesis chapter 21, verse 8 to 21. I repeat, Genesis chapter 21, verse 8 to 21. And I'm reading right away. So the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, scoffing. Therefore, she said to Abraham, "Cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be here with my son, namely with Isaac." And the matter was very displeasing in Abraham's sight because of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not let it be displeasing in your sight because of the lad or because of your bondwoman. Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her voice, for in Isaac your seed shall be called. Yet I will also make a nation of the son of the bondwoman, because he is your seed." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and put it on her shoulder. He gave it to her and the boy, and sent her away. Then she departed, wandering in the desert, in the wilderness of Beersheba. And the water in the skin was used up, and she placed the boy under one of the shrubs. Then she went and sat down across from him at a distance of about a bow shot, for she said to herself, "Let me not see the death of my boy." So she sat opposite him and lifted up her voice and wept, and God heard the voice of the lad. Then the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said to her, "What are you bothered about, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad and hold him with your hand, for I will make him a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water, and she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad to drink. So God was with the lad, and he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became an archer. He dwelt in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother took a wife for him from the land of Egypt. And this is the word of the Lord. My dear people of God, yesterday we took time to reflect on what happened between Sarah and Hagar and Abraham. We saw that the family had a problem. There was crisis in the family. There was misunderstanding between the two wives of Abraham, Hagar and Sarah. And so when Sarah suggested to Abraham to sleep with a maid servant being Hagar, and Abraham consented and eventually slept with Hagar, and then Hagar now became pregnant. But in the course of time, there was problem between Hagar and Sarah, and so Sarah insisted that Hagar must leave the family. So Abraham was now pressured to divorce Hagar. Now, this was what we discussed yesterday. When Hagar went out and went to the desert in the wilderness by this riverside, And she was there with her pregnancy in sorrow. And she was crying. Then God now sent a word to her. And God comforted her. And God told her to go back to Sarah. Now, that was the end of discussion yesterday. And we gave that talk yesterday. God sees the abandoned and the rejected. God sees the abandoned and the unwanted. Okay? Because Sarah rejected Hagar. Abraham rejected Hagar. Now, in today's story, it happened to be that the same episode repeated itself again. Remember that yesterday we read Genesis chapter 16, verse 7 to 14. Now, but today we read Genesis chapter 21, verse 8 to 21. And what happened in the reading of today was a replica of what happened in Genesis chapter 16, verse 7 to 14. So, once again, there was problem between Sarah and Hagar. It's us. So, at the point of the story of today, Sarah already had Isaac. Ishmael already had, Hagar already had Ishmael. And Ishmael had, you know, grown to a certain age. And the two boys were not growing in the same family. Jesus. And one day, this woman called Sarah found out that the son of Hagar, Ben Ishmael, was speaking scornfully to Isaac, and she felt so bad about it. And she decided to suggest to Abraham to divorce Hagar this for the second time. And so Abraham was disturbed, but God advised Abraham to listen to Sarah because God intended that the child from Sarah would be the seed, the promised child for Abraham that God already promised him. So when the pressure was so much on Abraham, Abraham now divorced Hagar for a second time. All right? Yesterday we saw that Hagar was unwanted and was rejected in the family, and that led to the first divorce. And today, the same thing repeated itself again. Hagar was also unwanted in the family. She was rejected in the family, and she was divorced for the second time. And even though she was rejected and unwanted, yet God had a plan for her. My brothers and sisters, in the reading that we read, the Bible recorded that God, for the second time, spoke to Hagar in the wilderness. Now, I want you to take note of this very important remark, that in the first case of Genesis chapter 16, verse 7 to 14, Hagar left and went to the wilderness. You see, she had no other plan than moving to the wilderness. Jesus. And she was just soaked in tears. She was disturbed. She was in sorrow. And so she just packed her things and headed for the wilderness. And today again, she headed for wilderness. And while in the wilderness, the water she had with her finished. The food she had with her finished. And the boy, Ishmael, was now crying profusely. And this woman knew that the son was going to die. And so what she did was to drop this son. And they walked a distance. The idea was it would be better for the child to die. Okay? Without her witnessing it. She wanted to be somewhere, not being able to withstand the cry of the child. I mean, no woman will be able to withstand that. Your own child. So it makes sense that she was able to drop that child and she left that scenario, that scene, and traveled to another place and was there weeping. But God now heard the cry of the child, not even the cry of the mother. Jesus. The Bible said to that God spoke his word, the heaven opened, and God spoke his word to Hagar and said, Hagar, I have heard the cry of your son. I have heard the cry of your son. That's the message tonight, that those of you that if God cannot hear you, he will hear you because of someone. He will hear you because of your child. He will hear you because of somebody that is dear to him. Amen. Jesus. And so, my brothers and sisters, when God met her in the wilderness, God knew that this woman needed water, that the child needed water. And so what God did was to open the eyes of Hagar and revealed not water to her, but a well, a well. And so she took water and they gave to her child, and they were able to drink, and they had life. And they settled there in the wilderness of Paran. And when the child grew up, the mother got a wife for him, and then life continued for them. Now, you see that because God intervened in the situation, then the situation changed. You see, I want to let you know that no matter how bad your situation might look or may look like, when God steps in, things must change. Life must change. That shame must change, and you have the garment of joy. Yes, my Lord. And so, my brothers and sisters, we are calling on that same God to come and visit us. We are asking that God to come and touch us in a special way. Yes, my Lord. My brothers and sisters, I don't know how many of you that remember that the story of Hagar is still going on in the world today. There are faces of Hagar everywhere, and there are faces of Ishmael everywhere. People who have been rejected. You see, yesterday's talk was God sees the abandoned, and today we continue with that talk. And we're going to focus on Genesis chapter 21, verse 8 to 21. And the title for today's talk will be the same as that of yesterday, but this is the volume 2. I'm giving it volume 2 because of the similarity. But this is going to take us into a new dimension of prayers. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, when Hagar was in that desert, it was not a palatable place for her. I mean, before God visited her, it was a horrible place. It was for her a place of hopelessness. Hagar's cry was a cry without hope. She was had no hope. All right? She was not even praying to God. Remember, this was an Egyptian woman, Egyptian slave. She didn't know about prayer. She was not a Jewish woman who would have been trained on how to present situations to God. And so when she was leaving the house of Abraham, she was living without plan, and she was entering into the wilderness. You may begin to ask yourself, why was this woman entering into the wilderness? Do you remember that this woman was a slave? That she was bought by Abraham, who was indeed a rich man. So this woman, I'm talking about Hagar, didn't have a home anymore, any longer. She didn't even know her parents any longer. She had spent years in the family of Abraham. So where would she go to when she was rejected? She had to go to the wilderness. That was the reason why she went to the wilderness. Jesus. She went this time with her abandoned child. And so her voice was a voice of hopelessness, a cry without hope. But God saw that situation. God heard the voice of the boy, not hers. God paid attention to the boy's own voice, and God brought help. This story is an episode that portrays man's plight and God's grace. When Hagar was in the family of Abraham, she was eating well. She was having everything she wanted. She was living in surplus. But when situation took her out of the family of Abraham, she was living in scarcity, even to the point that she could not even have water to drink. She was in despair in the land of wilderness. Situation took her to the wilderness. I don't know how many of us that situations have taken us to the wilderness. Remember that the wilderness is an unfamiliar terrain, unfamiliar situation. If you're not familiar with good health, if you're not familiar with sickness, and now you now start having sickness, that is your own wilderness. And this bond servant, this slave girl, with her son, found themselves in unfamiliar terrain. And the God who was watching came into that situation. Jesus. I have a message for somebody today that whatever you are passing through, God is watching. God, who was kind to Hagar, will also be kind to you. You see how generous God is. Hagar was not even a Hebrew. She wasn't a Jewish. She was an Egyptian, a godless nation. A woman from a godless nation. Yet God showed her favor. God met her in her brokenness. When the whole world was collapsing on her, God showed her mercy. God saw her. God visited her. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, I have a question for you. How would you compare the situation of this woman in Genesis chapter 28, verse 8 to 21, where she left with nothing and took her son only with a bag of water and a little food, which got finished with time. And now she found herself in the wilderness. In this wilderness, there was no water at sight. That was why this child was crying. How do you compare that with the story of Genesis chapter 16, verse 7 to 14, where she was pregnant and headed for wilderness, but in that first story, she was now sitting and crying by the river in the wilderness. How do you compare them? At least in the first case, there was water. There was a river. She could find life there. She could do fishing there. And she was able to cook food there. She was able to drink water there. But in this case, this is the worst scenario. She was not just pregnant, but then she was having a child. And she was in a wilderness without river at sight. The second divorce was worse than the first divorce. My brothers and sisters, something we need to understand is that the devil that fought this woman out of her family so that she came back to the same family, that she came back into that place of comfort, that devil now had to increase the problems so that this woman would give up. And this is what happened to many of us. When we have the first challenge, first problem, and through prayers and God's intervention, then we're able to be restored. The devil doesn't give up. He now changes his scheme, changes his strategies, and then he comes with a worse situation. He comes with a reinforcement. He comes with a great attack. He comes to come and fight in a stronger way. He comes to mesmerize the situation. He wants you to give up. He intensified the troubles. Jesus. He intensified the crisis in the life of this woman. It's us. Many of us have passed through first stage of problems and we came out victoriously, but the same problem came up again in a worse way. And you don't know that this is an organized attack against you. But today, we are calling on the Almighty God, the King of Kings, the mighty man in battle. Let him come down and touch his people today. Let him come down and destroy every scheme of the devil. Even in the time of Jesus, remember that the devil was attacking him in different stages of his life, even when he was a baby, even when Jesus was a baby. He wanted to use Herod to kill him. He fell. And then in Luke chapter 4, verse 1, after the baptism of Jesus, and the Bible says that Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost and power. Then in Luke chapter 4, verse 2 to 13, you see the temptations of Jesus and how the devil tempted him several patterns using different schemes. Then in Luke chapter 4, verse 13, the Bible recorded that the devil gave up. When the devil had finished his tempting, he left him until an opportune time. He left Jesus for an opportune time. He waited for him in the Calvary. He waited to use the Pharisees, the scribes, the Jewish people, the government of the time to bring a heavier attack, a second degree attack on the life of Jesus. So the point I'm making today is that when the devil is attacking you, he comes to attack you at a certain level and you were able to resist him, you were able to overcome him, he comes with a higher level of attack. And that was the situation of Hagar. He saw us. Oh, Hagar was abandoned with her child. She herself now eventually abandoned her own child in the wilderness. Wow. Does that ring bell? Many times we inflict injury on others because of what people have done on us. Hagar was abandoned. Now she now abandoned her own child. You can't pay evil for evil. Jesus himself is teaching us to pay good for evil. That is, to do good to those who offend you, those who attack you, those who attack you in many forms. Sometimes people spend years pursuing retaliation. If that is the project that you are embarking on today, withdraw. Leave vengeance for God. Jesus. Hagar was divorced the second time, and the bitterness was very strong, and she was weeping bitterly. She had no joy again. She lost her joy. Many of us are that way. Many of us have had crises in marriage that have broken down and have led people to become victims. People are now having trauma because of divorce, because of first experience or second experience in marriage. That was the situation of Hagar. So I've met people who are even afraid of marrying again, because the first five marriages ended up in divorce, in crisis, in shame. But the way God visited Hagar, gave her hope, gave her life, and then transformed her, and even blessed her child, tells us that God can revive and restore our stolen glory. Hagar was not praying in the wilderness. She was just there crying. And you think that if God would give her attention, if her tears would get the attention of heaven, would you think that God will not do better in your life? You that is the son or daughter of the kingdom of God. You that pray to him day and night, you think he will ignore you? The God who saw Hagar in her bad and ugly situation, that same God is still going about doing good. Acts 10, verse 38 says, Jesus, filled the power of the Holy Ghost, is going about doing good. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, there are lessons to learn from the situation of Hagar. Why was it that this woman lost her marriage and then lost her marriage the second time? It makes sense to see that there was a spirit following her, following Hagar, that doesn't want Hagar to have a family of her own. A spirit was following her to make sure that she would never have a marriage, a workable marriage. I have met people who have told me that they have married 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. I say, brother, I'm tired. Brother, I am ashamed of myself. The first marriage failed. The second marriage failed. The third marriage failed. This cannot be the will of God. Jesus. I don't know what is the situation you are passing through. Maybe marriage has failed even more than 6 times. Maybe men have proposed marriage 15 times and they have failed. But remember that God located Hagar in her misery, in her crisis, in her broken heart, in her broken marriage, and God repackaged her. God reconstructed her. You think God will not locate you, even though that situation may be so bad? In the life of Hagar, there was an embargo on marriage. There was an embargo that decrees, thou shalt not get married. And that embargo was following her. But in their own time, they had no minister of deliverance that would pray and break that yoke. And she was going about with that yoke. Probably there was a sweet husband in her life that swore that she would never get married and causing problem in the marriage. Jesus. But we are praying today that every embargo on the life of the children of God, embargo on marriage, must be broken down. Embargo on our finances, on our good health, must be broken down today. Embargo on favor, embargo that says we cannot have good job, embargo that says we shall work for nothing. Even when the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 65, verse 23, that my people shall not work for nothing. Makerebo shereba. Such embargoes. I am standing on the word of God to command such embargoes to begin to melt, to begin to expire. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Every embargo. Embargo against the children of God that is following them about. Every embargo against the children of God saying they will not have progress in life. Let such embargoes in the name of Jesus begin to break now. Begin to break now. Begin to break now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Every embargo following me about, following my career, following my destiny, I command you now, in the name of Jesus, be broken right now. Be broken right now. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, my terrible. The Lord heard the voice of the lad, and heaven opened. And the Lord will hear your voice today, and heaven will open for you. Maybe you are in your own wilderness, but I'm praying that this new month, that God will locate you in that wilderness, that God will restore your dignity, that God will open the doors of favor in the name of Jesus, that he will wipe your tears in the name of Jesus, that every embargo that has been following you
Since the month of November, since the month of November last year, the month of December last year, since the month of January to today, that embargo be following you. I command that embargo in the name of Jesus, expire. You can follow us through this month again. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Touch your people. Touch your people. Father, touch your people. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Every garment, garment of shame, garment of embargo, limiting your people. Let those embargo, those linen cloths, those grave cloths, let them begin to tear into two. In the name of Jesus. Let them break into pieces. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. The Bible says, John chapter 11, verse 44. Urobo Shereba. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Take off the grave cloths and let him go. Every grave cloths of embargo against the children of God under the apostolic anointing. I command that grave cloths to break into pieces according to John 11, verse 44. Take off the grave cloths and let him go now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. According to Mark chapter 15, verse 38, the Bible says that the temple veil shall be turned into two from top to bottom. And I command every veil, veil of limitation, veil of embargo, veil against your marriage, veil against your life, against your good health, and I command them now to expire and tear into two. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. The only hope of Ishmael was the mother. The mother was something he had. But now, the mother was abandoned. And even rejected. Jesus. There are people who are abandoned by their only hope. Remember, the mother was abandoned. The mother took the child. Now, in the desert, the mother saw that the chances of the son surviving was very slim. So she now abandoned her child. The only hope of Ishmael to survive was the mother. Now the mother abandoned the child. That reminds me how women give birth to babies and then they will keep their such babies, abandon them on trash, on the garbages, on the streets, on dark corners, and child will be weeping, crying day and night. I'm sure you have heard such stories. Jesus. Oh. Jesus. The only hope for Ishmael was the mother. But now the devil attacked the mother in order to frustrate Ishmael. There are people that are under attack because they are the only hope for a family or for a business or for a company or for a nation. They are under attack. Most parents have been unjustifiably abandoned by their own children for the same reason. The devil knows that these children, if they look after their parents will have a happy old age. But the devil is not happy. And so they will start attacking the children to make the children not to feel like thinking about their parents. Can you imagine? The person that diapered you, fed you, and they took care of you, paid your fees, and then you grew up, and you don't want to see the person again. And you may be wondering, could it be possible? I am here to tell you, I hear this all the time. There are spirits that are causing such problems. We are remembering such families, such parents, that their children have abandoned. Whether it was a human being that did a manipulation diabolically and is resulting in such broken relationships, we are calling on the Almighty God in heaven to come down in power and restore that very relationship in the name of Jesus. Father, mother relationship, parents-children relationship, Let there be such healing now. Let such healing begin to take place in the name of Jesus. Every broken relationship in the family, we command such to begin to break now in the name of Jesus. Oh, Makere Boshereba, begin to come on Jesus. Let the power of Jesus come of Nazareth. Begin to restore such families in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, let him touch our families. For the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, for he himself is our peace. Yes, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility that is in the family. It's been broken now. It's been broken now. In the name of Jesus, we command such a wall of hostility, such a dividing walls in families. Let them be broken now. In the name of Jesus, let the children begin to come back to their senses. In the name of Jesus, every wall of division in their families that have brought confusion, even the family of Abraham, may such God Almighty come down and destroy such a wall of division, such a wall of hostility. In the name of Jesus, yes, my Lord, let the blood of Jesus begin to touch them now, begin to heal you now, begin to heal your family, begin to bandage your family. In the name of Jesus, let him touch your people. Father, touch your children. Papa, touch your people. The hour has come for a divine touch. A divine touch. A divine touch. Papa, touch your people. Oh, Robo Shereba. Father, touch your people now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Ha ha. Oh. Hagar. Married and failed. Second marriage, came back to the marriage, failed again. And this reminds me, in algebra, what is called recurring decimal point. You have something like 2.3333. It will never come to an end. There are problems like that. Recurring problems. They continue to move from generation to generation. You never see the end of that. There's my point. The figures will continue to roll. The only way to stop such figures going to roll is to declare what you call decimal point system. So when you say two decimal points, they mean that that problem can never go beyond the second stage. You force it to be at 2.33. If it is first decimal point, then it cannot go beyond the first degree. But as children of God, what would we use to stop that problem, to pin that recurring problem, that recurring decimal point? What is the concept, the spiritual concept, the spiritual power that is needed to stop it? It is the power of prayer. It is the power of the blood of Jesus. Those who know the power in that name, they will do great exploits even to stop the recurring decimal point in their life, the recurring problems in their lives. Hagar had the first divorce, second divorce, and who knows, maybe she married another person. The Bible didn't tell us about that. But being a young lady, she may have married other people, and they may have ended up in divorce. Because there is a recurring problem, a recurring decimal point in her life. I don't know what is the recurring decimal point in your life. I don't know what is the recurring problem in your life. Maybe you have attempted several businesses and they have failed several times. They may have failed as many times as you have tried. Maybe there is a particular pattern for you to lose marriage. Maybe there's a particular pattern for you to have that miscarriage. A woman told me that if it's conceiving, she will always conceive. But each time she sees a naked woman in the dream, she will have miscarriage. It's a pattern that's taking place years. Some of the person told me that each time she conceives and she sees blood in the dream, then miscarriage. You see, there is a pattern. Brothers and sisters, there is something called evil pattern. One day in the prayer line, we're going to pray against evil pattern. There is such evil pattern in the life of the children of God that need to be broken so that the children of God will have their own life in full. Jesus. Hello. A sister was talking to me the other day. I said, her marriage was broken. She had a divorce. All her five siblings, five sisters, all of them came out from their marriage. I mean, when she was telling me this some months ago, I saw a pattern. A pattern. How could five girls from a family, the only five girls, all of them, left their marriages? You see, that's the pattern. It doesn't matter place. That such system must be broken in the name of Jesus. There are people that their business will be going well, but all of a sudden, it will collapse. It happened to father. It happened to, he heard the story of what happened to his great-grandfather. The same pattern. I don't know the pattern that you are passing through now. I don't know what is the old situation. But I'm here to call on the Lord for you. That every pattern, demonic pattern, evil pattern, evil label, demonic concept, occultic concept, or process that is at work in your life, under the anointing that breaks every manner of yoke, I am calling upon heaven to come down and locate you in that situation and break that barrier and break that evil in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Let the Lord begin to fight for you now. In Zechariah chapter 11, verse 1, the Bible says, open your doors, Lebanon. I am here to command you, let your doors open now in the name of Jesus. I don't know who is the Lebanon, but I'm praying for you now. Let the doors open. Jesus, my Lord and my Father, my Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who anointed me while I was still in my mother's womb, I am calling on you, Lord, to anoint this message, to anoint this message of this very night to the level of shattering gates, to the level of melting irons, to the level of pulling down tragedies, to the level of creating the money decimal point system, Rabo Shere Baba, to the level of truncating every recurring problem in the life of your people, every pattern, every demonic pattern, I command them to break now in the name of Jesus. For the Bible says, Isaiah chapter 45, verse 2, I will go before you. I will level the mountains. I will break down the gates of bronze. I will cut through the bars of iron in the name of Jesus. Every bars of iron that is in your life, every gate of bronze that I've kept in captivity, under the apostolic anointing, under another amazing yoke, I command that iron gate to begin to melt down. To begin to melt down, to begin to melt down, to begin to melt down, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Oh, Jesus. Every wind of captivity, every wind of adversity in the life of the children, every tempest, every demonic tempest blowing in your life, blowing you to the wilderness, blowing you to the land of ugliness, into the land of poverty. I am calling upon Jesus, the storm comer, the storm comer. Let him break the yoke. Let him break the yoke in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Oh, Jesus. Hey. Oh. I can feel anointing moving heavily. I can feel anointing moving heavily. Yakendere bobo keri baba. Maride sendere bobo ri baba. Every spirit husband frustrating people's marriage, I command you right now. Me kendere bo. In the name of Jesus, begin to come out of my people. Begin to come out of my people. And begin to go to rabbis. In the name of Jesus, burn by fire. Every strong man standing at the gate of success, every strong man frustrating your marriage, every strong man standing at the gate of your I command to decay in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Oh, Jesus. The Bible says in Zechariah chapter 14, verse 12. Look at what the Bible says. The Bible says, their flesh will rot while they are still standing on their feet. Their eyes will rot in their sockets, and their tongues will rot in their mouth. Please, I need somebody to interpret this for me. Jesus. What I'm hearing the Bible saying is that that strong man, that spirit of embargo, that spirit that is causing demonic or Hebraic decimal point that is recurrent in your life, the Bible says that while they are still alive, that while their flesh will rot while they are standing up. They are standing up, talking, boosting, and look at the maggots coming out of them. That is rotting taking place. You're already familiar with maggots coming out from dead things, carcass. But now, what you have not heard is that maggot is coming out from that demon spirit, that spirit that is calling itself alive, that Goliath that is standing before you, boasting. God said, why that Goliath is boasting and is still alive? Maggot is coming out. Zechariah 14, verse 12 is my witness. That was what happened to the man called Herod. When Herod was attacking the disciples of Jesus, and he saw that it was pleasing to the Jews, so he intensified the attack, killing them. Already he succeeded in killing James. The disciples of Jesus were scattered here, ever, everywhere. Then, when Herod called for a council meeting, and he was addressing the people, already he had the gift of oration. So he spoke so well, so moving, so enticing, that people started to hail him. Hey, Herod, you talk like God. In fact, you are God. All this while, God had been patient with Herod to repent. But when he tried to boast, even to accept that he was God, God could not hold it any longer. Right there, do you know that the Bible said that he fell down and they rotted, that the maggots started to come out of him. And that's what the Bible is talking about in Zechariah 14, verse 12. He said, why they are they standing up? Their flesh will rot. Their eyes, their eyeballs will rot in the socket. You don't need to be a biology student before you understand that the eyeball has a socket. The one that made the eyes and made the socket, gave the whole geometry of the human anatomy. He himself is now saying that he will cause the eyes of the wicked to rot in the sockets. He said that their tongues will rot in their mouths. This is not what we're talking. This is the Bible. This is the scripture. Jesus. Whatever thing that has been packaged in the occultic headquarters, in the demonic headquarters, that have been assigned, that have been launched like a rocket, and they sent it to your territory to come and pull you down, to come and bring tragedy into your life, to come and take you into the wilderness. I am calling on divine vindication for you. I am calling on Jesus for you. Let him come and deliver you. Yes, my Lord. Let him come and vindicate you. In the name of Jesus, every stumbling stone, I command it to expire. Let them burn into pieces. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, there is something called SSS, SSS, Satanic Stumbling Stone, SSS, and there's something called DSS, Divine Stepping Stone. Jesus, what I'm praying for you today, hey, that in this month, in this new month, in this
my people, that whatever thing you take your hand this month shall prosper. That God will vindicate you. Oh, in the book of Judges, chapter 15, verse 15, the Bible says that God empowered Samson such that he used the jawbone of a donkey, to kill 1,000 men. When the enemies came against Samson, Samson had no catapult. He had no gun. Nothing was with him. He looked around, and then he saw a jawbone. And he took it. The jawbone of a donkey. He took it. And the Bible says he grabbed it. And then he used it to strike down 1,000 men. Oh, yeah. He says, lift up your right hand, because I'm going to pray over that your hand, so that the power that was in the hand of Samson that made him even to use the jawbone to kill 1,000 men, that anointing will come into your hands, so that anytime you lift up your hand in prayer, demons, 1,000 demons will be falling down, and they will be electrocuted, and they will be dried up, they will be destroyed in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. And the Bible says in Judges chapter 3, verse 31, that God anointed the hand of Shamgar. He anointed the hands of the man called Shamgar. And the Shamgar, under that anointing, used what is called even the yoke. Oh, Makeribu Shereba. He used the oxen yoke to kill, to destroy 600 men. What anointing is still available today for you? For this new month, I am praying for your hand to become anointed, so that your hands will be doing exploits in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, that anywhere you have been conquered, from today, you will be victorious in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, whatever exam that this hand will write this month is going to end up in success in the name of Jesus. The power is moving now. Anointing coming into the hand. Receive that anointing now. Receive that anointing now. In the name of Jesus, I am praying for you. I am praying for you. The Bible says, Proverbs chapter 7, verse 17, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. I am sharpening your iron now, even as you are sharpening my own iron. And I'm praying for you now, that from today, you are a spiritual hunter. You are a spiritual hunter. I declare you a hunter. You will go into the wilderness, and you will destroy demons. You will hunt them down. You will destroy them now. Orobo Sherebaba. Makenderibo Sereba. Begin to receive an anointing now. In the name of Jesus. Makeribo Sereba. I am praying for you. Let the power of the Holy Ghost, the power of the Samson, that made him to kill a lion, that made David to kill Goliath. I am praying for you now, that this is your own time. This is your own time. Your time to be a conqueror. In the name of Jesus. Ribobo Sereba. The power is moving now. The power is moving now. In the name of Jesus, somebody is coming out now. Somebody coming out from the graveyard. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The power is moving now. The power is moving now. Anointing for increase. Anointing for increase. Receive that anointing now. The anointing is moving now. And the Bible says, Psalm 107, verse 38, he blessed them also so that they multiplied. And they suffered not to decrease. I am praying for you that in this month of September, you shall increase in the name of Jesus. Your finances shall increase in the name of Jesus. Professionally, you shall increase in the name of Jesus. I minister professional breakthrough, professional breakthrough, ministerial breakthrough, spiritual breakthrough, spiritual breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Oh, my carry Bosheba. Promotion, promotion, promotion. I minister that right now in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. I call upon Jesus for you. Let him vindicate you. Makiri Babera. Let him destroy every work of the devil as against you. Let him be destroyed now. Let him be destroyed now. The blood of Jesus. Receive that anointing. Receive that anointing now. Jesus. Take it. Jesus. Ha! Oh. When a woman is pregnant, then at the ninth month, she will be called expectant mother to deliver. That is, you may call her expectant mother from the beginning of conception, but at the ninth month, she is ready to go to the labor room. Brother, do you remember that this is the ninth month of the year? Huh? Is it not time for somebody to go to the labor room? Jesus. Maybe all this time you have been expectant. You have been praying for a breakthrough. You are praying for a miracle. You have been praying for a new dispensation. Something new you have been crying for. Oh, Jesus. Oh, the Bible says in John chapter 11, verse 44, Jesus says, hey, untie him and set him free. Take off the grave cloth and let him go. And I'm here to pray for you that it is time for you to receive anointing to enter into the labor room. Somebody will deliver his Isaac today. Somebody will deliver her somewhere today. Somebody will become favorable today. Somebody will enter into the labor room to go and deliver marriage, to go and get married today. There are nothing for open that they come in now. Divine breakthrough, divine breakthrough. Somebody going to the labor room. I am going to the labor room this night. Even the Rogue is going to the labor room. The men are going to the labor room now. In the name of Jesus. Because I've been pregnant. I've been pregnant of favor. I've been pregnant of promotion. And today, the divine signature is coming to approve my promotion today. In the name of Jesus. Those who are praying for the gift of vision, the gift of miracles, the gift of prayer. Today you are going to the labor room. For you are receiving divine unction. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. People have been called barren. Oh yeah, get ready. I say get ready and go to the labor room. It's time for you to change. It's a time of change. It's a time of change. For the Bible says, Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 11. He said, the winter is over. Oh, Sheriba. My people, I am here to announce for you that the winter is over. In this my ninth month, the winter is over. I am going forward. In the name of Jesus, I am going to my land, the land of praise, the land of praise, the land of praise. And the Bible says, Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, and Abraham and his family, they went to the land of Canaan, the land of praise, the land of Judah, a land of miracles, a land of favor, something that will make me to praise God. That day is coming now, in the name of Jesus. Oh. Receive the breath of power that will shatter every iron bars, that will melt every bronze gate. According to Isaiah 45, verse 2, I command such powers to begin to melt, to begin to melt, to begin to melt. My people, I prophesy Psalm 71, verse 21, for the Bible says, thou shalt increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. I don't know who is comfort. Lord Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, will comfort you this month. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. The angels are coming down. Look at the angels everywhere. Look at them everywhere. Father, Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for sending the angels. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Look at the angels everywhere. Look at them moving now. Look at them touching somebody. Look at them touching somebody. So come and change your story. Come and change your story. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Yes, my Lord. I thank you, Jesus, because of what you are doing. I thank you, Jesus, for coming to vindicate our people. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. The Bible says, Isaiah chapter 14, verse 5, the Lord has broken the rod of the wicked. Yes, my Lord. The scepter of the rulers, the scepter of the wicked, shall be broken today, shall be broken this month. In the name of Jesus, in my family, the rod of the wicked shall be broken today. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. According to Psalm 125, verse 3, the Bible says that the scepter of the wicked shall not be found in the house of the righteous. In the name of Jesus, I prophesy it to your life. In the name of Jesus, anointing of bread yoke is moving now. Let the anointing touch you. Let him touch you. Let him touch you. Jesus, every demonic decimal place, I command them now, in the name of Jesus, let them be truncated. Let them be truncated. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Divine unction. Unction for new things. Yes, Lord. People that are living in misery, living in shame. Ah, I declare a new season for you. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, I am calling on the Lord for you. Let him touch you. Let him touch you. Let him touch you. Let him touch you. A divine touch. A divine touch. A Eucharistic touch. Let the hand of Jesus begin to touch somebody. Begin to touch somebody. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Touch our people. In the name of Jesus. My dear people of God, do you know that when this problem came to Hagar in Genesis chapter 16, verse 7 to 14, and in Genesis chapter 21, you see a pattern in the life of Hagar. Hagar just hurriedly left the family and went to the desert, went to the wilderness. There was no plan. She had no plan. Hagar had no place at all for her life. She just entered into that mission. Many of us, when problem comes, we don't even have a plan. We just enter into the problem headlong. That's a wrong approach. If you read Genesis 16, verse 8, you see where the angel was asking Hagar, asking her, where are you coming from? And where are you going to? Did you not notice that? Now, Hagar answered the first question. The first question was, where are you coming from? She answered it very well. She said, I am running away from my mistress, Sarah. That was a good answer. Now, she did not answer the second question because the second question was demanding for a plan. The second question says, and where are you going to? She had no place going to. She just headlong entered into the problem. He just made a shorter prayer. Many of us enter into what just without thinking, without praying, we just enter into things, into marriages, into business, without praying. Jesus. Oh, but we are praying that God will help us to bring our problems to the Lord in prayer. To learn how to bring our situations to the Lord in prayer. Even this month of September, we shall pass through this month bringing everything to the Lord. Every challenge to the Lord. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 to 6, trust in me with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Many of us lean on our own understanding. But God says no. Psalm 37 verse 5 says, commit thy ways unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Do you want that plan to come to pass? Bring it to the Lord. In this month, we are prophesying that the hand of Jesus will direct every affair of our life. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. We ask God to be in our front and lead us this month. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. So we can see that Hagar had no plan of where to run to. Unless you call running away from home a plan. If that is a plan, okay, then we can work with that. But that's not a plan. Jesus. But that was her only option. Because she didn't know how to seek God in prayer. We're asking God in this month to teach us how to seek the face of God. My brothers and sisters, I wish to also bring to your attention that while Hagar was in the wilderness crying in bitterness, and God heard the cry of the lad, do you know that God provided water? Not just water. God provided a well of water, a well full of water, pure water, drinkable water, not the one that is smelling. All right? God, all this time, Hagar didn't know there was a well there. She didn't know. But the Bible said that God opened her eyes and she saw that drink, that water, that well. And you know what? The moment she saw that well, she settled there. She started to live there. She made her home there. She now got a wife for the son when the son grew up. You see, so God used that water, that well, to solve her problems. I am praying for you that even in your desert, in your wilderness, let God bring forth a well. Let him bring forth a well of salvation for you, a well that will change your situation, a well that will be a solution to that your problem. I am ministering that to your life in the name of Jesus. Let him open the doors of heaven for you. Yes, my Lord. So that those who are in the wilderness, they will drink water, the water of life. I am praying for you that in that wilderness, you shall not be there alone. That God will open the door. That God will bring salvation. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Even though this woman was disregarded or unwanted in the family of Abraham, yet God provided for her in that wilderness. Jesus. Hagar was not the only woman whom the Lord met at a well in the scripture. You remember the story in John chapter 4 where the Bible told us about a woman that was at the well and Jesus met her there. And the one that Jesus told all everything about her life. You remember that that woman was an outcast. She was unwanted. She had already married several men, but not living with anyone. You see something similarity between that woman's life and the life of Hagar? You see that there was a spirit that was making sure they were not living in marriage. But you know what? God met them at the well's side. And I'm praying for you that God will meet you at your well side. And if there is no well beside you, may God make a well for you. In the name of Jesus, let him make a way for you. Let him make a well for you. I prophesy in this month a well of salvation, a well of favor, a well of open doors in the name of Jesus. Let that well spring forth. Let that well spring forth in the name of Jesus. I pray against every well that is not of God. I stand against them today. I pray the Almighty God will make that well available for you in the name of Jesus. In Isaiah chapter 12, verse 3, the Bible says, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And I prophesy that in this month of September, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. In the name of Jesus, your well shall not run dry. In the name of Jesus, your glory shall not run dry. In the name of Jesus, the Lord shall provide for you. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Father, touch your people. In the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Touch your people. Touch your people. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Let there be a divine touch. Even for those people that the world have called unwanted. May the Lord vindicate you. May the Lord remove that social stigma that is in your life. Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Let the Lord hear your cry. As he hear the cry of Hagar and Ishmael, let the Lord hear your cry. Let your voice pierce heaven in this month, in the name of Jesus. Your testimony shall come this month. I prophesy it. I shall receive my testimony this month. I shall celebrate my testimony this month. People shall hear my testimony this month. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. May the Lord bless you. May he vindicate you. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Every problem that had defied solution, may the Lord Almighty bring solution for you in this very month. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Let him touch you. Let him touch you. Let him be with you. Let him open doors. In the name of Jesus. We are praying for children. Children over the world who have been rejected. Just like Ishmael, we are praying for them now. Children who have never known what is kiss, who have not known what is love, we are praying for them. People, children who are motherless, who are fatherless, we are praying for them now. May the Lord touch them. The Lord, I hear the cry of Ishmael. Let the Lord hear their own cry. My people, open your mouth now and begin to pray for children. Children all over the world, pray for them now. The Lord shall touch them. Jesus, the children over the world who have no person for their tuition, no person to send them to school, who have no medical attention, no person to care for them. We are praying for them now. Let the Lord touch them. In the name of Jesus, children who have been sold because they have nobody to fight for them, we are praying now for them. Let the Lord vindicate them. The Lord is moving now. The power of God is moving now. Let the Lord touch them now. Yes, my Lord. My people pray, 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 pray. Don't say that you don't have a child. Therefore, you're not going to pray. As you pray for this people, the Lord will also bless you. Open your mouth and pray. Let the Lord touch you. Let the Lord vindicate you. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, my people, there is no place so desolate that you can, that God cannot find you. Anywhere you are, the God who found Hagar will also find you. I want to repeat again. There is no place so desolate that you cannot find God there. God is touching you now. Oh, Jesus, when Hagar fled from her mistress, Sarah, into the wilderness, she thought that God was no more with her, that God had forsaken her, but that's not true. God was with her. For in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, the Bible says, I will never forsake you, nor shall I leave you. I am praying for you. The Lord shall strengthen you, my people. Jesus, that as a Hagar encountered God in the wilderness, in that desolate place, the Lord shall also encounter you. In that very place, he will meet you. In the name of Jesus, the Lord shall address your problem there. In the name of Jesus, I am praying for you. May the grace of the Lord be with you. That in this month, that God will bless you. That God will bring you a radiant light upon your life. May he touch you. May he make way for you. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Father, Lord, pour your flesh upon your people. A dew of oil, an oil of power upon your people. This month, the Lord is my light. In this very month, I will not grow up in darkness. The Lord shall be my light. He will show me what to do. He will give me direction. He will be my light this month. In the name of Jesus. I shall never walk in darkness. Yes, my Lord. The light of the Lord shall shine upon my heart. In the name of Jesus, he shall give me wisdom to follow things of this month. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, he will give me heavenly perspective. In the name of Jesus, I refuse to be confused this month. In the name of Jesus, yes, my Lord, the Lord is my refuge this month. I am running to him for safety. In the name of Jesus, as I run to him with my family, we shall be safekeep. We shall have our safety in him, for he is our strength and safekeeping. In the name of Jesus, he is our strength. Yes, my Lord, Father, we call on you. Come and take over. Yes, come and help your people. Jesus, vindicate your people from every malicious intentions of the devil. Father, Lord, we are praying now. Jesus, remove, O Lord, every hostility and opposition that will rise against your people. For you are the strength of your people. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, come and reestablish your people. In the name of Jesus, heal your people, Lord, and touch your people. May your mighty name be glorified now and forever. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen.